our Croatian adventure, we're going to be island hopping the coastline of Croatia from Split down to Dubrovnik. In our last episode, I shared some of the great things I saw and did early on as I worked my way from the capital Zagreb to Plitvice Lakes, one of my favorite areas of my whole 5-month adventure, over to the coastline of Zadar and then down to Split. Exploring Croatia by bike and getting around via the boat was magical, and I can't wait to share it with you. So let's get started. Welcome to the Active Travel Adventures podcast. I'm your host, Kit Parks. Today, I'm super excited to share with you my island hopping adventure in Croatia, one of the true gems of the Adriatic Sea. Like I said, the last time we spoke, I had already worked my way down to Split. I'd met up with Jenny, who you met on the Flagstaff episode, and I was getting ready to join our group that was put together by Traveling Jackie, that I'll put a link in the show notes to that, on a tour with my new affiliate, BoatBikeTours.com. On their guided group tours, not only do they arrange for the transportation via some gorgeous yacht, we were on a, I don't know how long it was, but it was a double-sailed mast motor yacht, truly exquisite, held, I believe, up to 32 of us on board, pretty cool. They also plan all the logistics. You have great guides. They take care of just about all of your meals. It's a really nice turnkey, easy to figure out solution. It's a great way to explore Europe. So I'll put links to all this stuff in the show notes. Please be sure to visit the website for more details on that. And let's get to Split, where our first night is party night as we get to know our group a little bit better with the help of a little bit of adult beverages. That first night, we bonded with tons of laughing, storytelling, and dancing. It was a great way to start off our adventure. Crew member Lucy, the daughter of the captain, was both our DJ as well as bartender, and she sure kept us on our feet. In the morning, it was time for our first ride. Our outstanding guides, Sinad and Lucia, gave us a briefing each morning after breakfast to tell us what we'd be doing each day. Both guides have a wonderful sense of humor, and they played well off each other. They're also very knowledgeable about the landscape and history and gave us a solid knowledge of this beautiful country of theirs. The plan is to visit a different island each day and then to explore that island by bike. You can either bring your own bike or do, as I believe all of us did, rent a bike as part of our tour. In addition to the briefing, they put a summary of the times that we're supposed to be somewhere, say mealtime or bike time, on a whiteboard. They also have a laminated map that they draw on each day in pink marker, showing us where we're going that day so we can visualize it. On another whiteboard with the name of the crew, list the day's menus, plus over time people write in some funny sayings that became part of our personal vernacular, our inside jokes of this particular tour. With my travels and earlier hiking tours, I didn't have much opportunity to get bike training in, but I felt pretty comfortable that my legs, lungs, and heart could take on the biking. My biggest concern, though, was my bottom. Could it hold up to multiple hours on a bike seat day after day? That was the question. To help mitigate this problem, I bought new bike shorts for maximum gel padding, and I also bought a new bike gel seat that I planned to leave behind after the trip for somebody else to use. That first morning, we cruised over to the island of Brač for a lovely ride to the other side of the island, where the captain picked us up. Brač is famous for its precious limestone, some of which was used to build the White House. We cycled the picturesque town of, oh, I'm going to really butcher these names, sorry, Putsitsia, across the island over to Bol. The biking total for the day is about 14 miles or around 23 kilometers. I remember chuckling over somebody spray painting on the road in large letters as we rode up the hill. Need, and about 10 feet later, more, another 10 feet later, cowbells. I totally agree. We were never under any pressure to go at a particular pace. While we were given a map, there was one guide in the lead and another in the rear, and we'd all meet up at a change of a direction so that nobody, Alicia notwithstanding, could get lost. Delightful and funny Alicia could, on occasion, wander, usually pursuing a cute animal. While we were often riding on roads, these were really rural roads with very little traffic, and everybody was great about calling out car front or car back so we could tighten up our line. I never felt antsy or twitchy riding on the roads, even though I normally prefer to be off-road. Nonetheless, I still wore my neon yellow windbreaker as added protection, but I really don't think it was necessary and I could have left that behind. Of course, the roads we drove on showcased the stunning scenery of the six islands that we visited. We rode along rocky cliffs overlooking the crystal clear blue seas. We biked through centuries-old villages filled with charming stone homes with red-tiled roofs and centuries-old churches. Fairyland villages, I call them. Often in these villages, we had time to wander around and stop in some of the mini cafes for an espresso or cappuccino. Because of the mild climate, in Croatia, or at least on the coastline, the mild climate, I should point that out, you'd see an abundance of pomegranate trees, just ripening while we were there, as well as many figs and pear trees. Of course, you're going to see thousands of olive groves, and our guide Lucia, at the end of this tour, was heading back toward the family farm to start picking the olives, as many across the countryside were starting to do. In addition to the olive groves, you're also going to see lots and lots of wine vineyards. And the wine here is good, cheap, and abundant. You can buy a decent table wine for about $5 or $6 in 2021 when I'm recording this. I think the most expensive bottle I bought was $20, and frankly, I couldn't even tell the difference between that and the cheaper ones, but it could be because I bought it at a fancy shop when I was in the capital, instead of the local grocery store. Throughout my entire trip, I'd visit grocers to pick up snacks, and whenever I had an Airbnb, which was common on my trip, I'd buy more substantial food, and the prices were very reasonable as well. And back to the boat. We had enough free time before reboarding our ship to bike up to the Golden Horn, a famous beach known for its unusual curved shape. Then off we headed to Jelsa, a small town on the island of Hvar. The harbor of Jelsa is charming, and we have time to wander the streets. On one alley, I came across a storefront sign that said they allowed pets, smoking, eating and drinking, bathing suits, and every other thing that you can't normally do. And then the sign playfully said, plus you get 30% off if you shop nude. It was a humor snub at the do not signs we see everywhere these days. They also had a fine bronze statue of a donkey to honor the creature that made life in these rocky hills more manageable. Sitting by the shore, I struck up a fine conversation with a German woman who owns a second home here. Just having a regular conversation with somebody from a different country is one of my favorite things about traveling. On our second biking day on Hvar, we did about 22 miles or about 35 kilometers. We started first in Starigrad and biked our way across the island to the capital. We crossed lavender fields that must be absolutely glorious when they're in full bloom. There's a huge Spanish fortress on the hill overlooking the town. You get a great view from below, standing in picturesque Renaissance Square. In much of Europe, you're going to see castles, palaces, and walled cities and fortresses. The fortresses are generally on the highest point of the city, that or it's going to have a cathedral. When the fortresses were in use, the vegetation around the hill was removed to better spot an enemy arriving, but nowadays, development of vegetation often covers that hill. Regardless, they always provide outstanding views and are worth the often steep climb. The water of the Adriatic Sea could not be any clearer. And because it's so clear, it could be difficult to determine depths because you pretty much can always see the bottom. It is stunning. And at this time of year, it's also a bit chilly when we first take a dip in the sea. It takes your breath away when you first jump in, but I'd say after maybe 5 minutes, it switches to feeling refreshing. Our weather has been perfect, nice and sunny with delightful temperatures. Sometimes you want your jacket, but often you can sit out in shorts and a t-shirt and just enjoy the sunshine without getting too hot. This makes October a great time to visit, although in some of the islands we visit, since the tourists are gone, many of the restaurants are closed. However, we're eating most of our meals on board, and Lucy, our DJ and bartender, her sister is the chef. Breakfast is a buffet of breads, cheeses, fruits, and some kind of a meat. Then there's usually one hot offering, which varies daily. It could be eggs, pancakes, French toast, and the like. They're able to accommodate special diets, as we have a vegetarian and a couple of gluten intolerant bikers on board. Lunch was always a large two-course meal. Sometimes I had to tell Lucy I didn't have room for the second course. It was always quite good, with a nice variety of different cuisines. Dinner was no slouch either, and there's usually more food than I can eat, and that came with a dessert. Throughout the day, we could always snack on a bowl of fruit. And if you want other snacks, you can pick them up at our frequent cafe stops. One night, I think it was the second night, we had the captain's dinner, which is a typical Croatian mixed meat plate. Think an assortment of all kinds of grilled meats and vegetables. I mean, so much meat. It's like one plate is enough for, I would say, for the whole table, but we each got one of those. And of course, the captain joined us, and it became party night with lots of dancing and singing, again with Lucy being the DJ. Whenever we were cruising during the day, we could count on Lucy or Sana to offer up a lesson in history or attempt to teach us some local vocabulary. We got pretty good at molim for please and dobar dan for good day. Alicia was a pro at Dobro jutro, which means good morning. The island of Lastovo was fun to bike. I had opted for an e-bike for the same reason I did in the Dolomites in Slovenia. They've got real mountains over here, and I want a little extra oomph if I needed it. Jenny and about a half a dozen other bikers chose to ride a manual bike. Jenny mountain bikes a lot, but still, these were some pretty tough climbs at times, and I admit to being quite impressed. The others who rode a regular bike were 30 years younger than her. I was really impressed. Good on you, Jenny. I'm not sure I could have done it. If memory serves, on each of the islands, we'd bike up to a high point that we could get a panoramic view of the rocky coastline and the cute houses down below. Up on top, you'd see forested mountains, but with clearings for small villages and farmland. Croatia is one of the prettiest countries I've ever been to. Often along those Stova roads we biked, we'd see an animal smiley face subtly painted on the face of the rocks. However, unlike most graffiti, these were obtuse, and I did not find the spray paintings offensive. Rather, I found them cute. The artist would find a rock that had a protrusion that could be somebody's nose, to which he would add some whiskers, a smile, and a couple of eyeballs. In one little town we stopped by for a couple of hours to explore, the villagers pride themselves on how cute they could make their chimneys, called fumares. They are designed to draw the smoke out of the house, but are oriented so the smoke doesn't get blown back in. These are built over the kitchen and are tall and cylindrical. You'll see quite an array of unique designs on the red tiled roofs. Another distinction of Lastovo is that it's considered the second darkest sky in Europe, so you get a great chance to see the Milky Way, even with the naked eye, and small galaxies with even a small telescope. Normally, when I park myself or my car whenever I travel, I pin my location in the map app so I can always find my way back. Or I should say, I can find my way back after I get lost. Since we were right at the edge of the village on the sea, I didn't think to do so. On our break, I wanted to climb up the trail to see this abandoned, I think it was a fortress. But apparently I came back down the mountain on a different path, and what I didn't realize that because this town is on such a very steep slope, there were so many different hairpin turning streets on different elevations, I had no idea if I'd gone down too far or not far enough. Luckily, I ran into our friend Alicia again. Alicia, you're in this episode a lot today. And Alicia, who is often lost, but she knew where we were, and she pointed me back in the right direction. After a fun day of biking and exploring, we boated over to Vela Luka and Korčula, considered one of the most beautiful islands in Dalmatia. And that's saying something, because everything you see here is strikingly beautiful. Croatia, in fact, has more than 1,000 islands off its coastline, of which only 47 are inhabited, and then, usually that means just a few families. Boating is the perfect way to get a close-up view of many of these cute islands. Island hopping and then biking these islands is an even better way. When I mentioned Dalmatia, this is the name of the kingdom founded in 1812, which is part of the state of Slovens, Croats, and Serbs, which later became the Kingdom of Yugoslavia, and then after World War II, Dalmatia became part of the Socialist Federal Republic of Yugoslavia. I'm going to be talking more about the complicated history of this region in an upcoming episode on the Balkan states, of which Croatia is one. I spent about 3 months exploring this fascinating region, and I look forward to telling you all about it. But let's get back to our bike and boating tour. We never overnighted on the open water, but we'd be docked on the island so you could always get off to take a walk or explore the town. I noticed that all of us made it back for dinner. Most of us did our after-dinner play on the boat as well. Our next day of biking Korčula Island is a stunner. We ride almost 40 miles, about 60 kilometers. It's our longest day and the number one reason I booked an e-bike for this trip. On the long climb towards the end of the ride, I was so very glad I did. Did I mention how impressed I was with Jenny? In sympathy, I kept my bike in eco mode, that's the lowest mode you can put power on in your e-bike, so that I had to work pretty hard myself. The cute town of Korčula, with its fishbone street design, competes with Venice for the honor of being the birthplace of the famous explorer Marco Polo. Korčula is part of another famous legend. There is a legend that Zeus sent a delegate to find the most beautiful island on Earth. He couldn't decide between Lastovo, Korčula, or Mljet, and thus became petrified between these islands. We are lucky to visit all three of these beautiful islands on our adventure. Over the millennium, Korčula has varied from a mountain to an island depending on sea levels. During the last ice age, the Adriatic Sea was once a plain covered in ice with a climate similar to Scandinavia's today. During the early Stone Age, Vela Luka was a trading post of different cultures, and flint plus decorative items from the day have been discovered on the island. When the ice melted around 10,000 BC, Korčula again became an island. Instead of hunting the large mammals, they turn to fishing. The Vela Luka cave, which you can visit, is considered the finest example of Neolithic culture in this part of the world. The area now enjoys a delightful Mediterranean climate. In the village of Vela Luka, they have claim to the world's longest mosaic that runs the length of the sidewalk downtown. I particularly like the animal design mosaics. For a while, I watched an old man fish for squid. He has a large hook and a line with a fake crab on it. He throws the line out and slowly draws it back to him, and when a squid tries to eat the crab, he yanks. Jenny and I decide we're going to climb up the mountain to take in the sunset from above. We also learn that a bottle of wine conveniently fits in our large water bottles, so we have a nice drink as we drink in the view. Wine in this region, as I mentioned, is as good as it is inexpensive. The following day, we head to the beautiful island Lastovo, one of the smallest inhabited islands in the Adriatic Sea. The Emperor Augustus appreciated the mild climate on the island, and in Roman times, it was even named Augustus Insula after him. The population of just over 800 still lives mainly from fishing in the surrounding rich fish waters, agriculture, and viticulture, particularly their white wine. In one place where we sat down our bikes to walk out to a point, you see grass called Neptune grass under the water. This important and protected plant life is considered the lungs of the sea. It was fun watching the waves crash against the rocky shore, as well as see the variety of plants that cling to nooks and crannies in the rock, surviving somehow. I especially liked a pale blue flax-like plant that was in full bloom. Another thing we liked was seeing the occasional "Beware the Wild Boar" signs. Today's ride was pleasant at around 18 miles, about 28 kilometers, and the next day, biking Mljet would be about the same distance. We biked through the green forest covering most of this island. About 70% of Mljet is forest, making it the most forested island of the Mediterranean region. Homer mentions this pretty island in the Odyssey. It was the nymph Calypso's home, and King Odysseus, who couldn't resist Calypso, stayed in the island for 7 years. Our final day of biking was on Sipan Island, the largest of the Elafiti Islands, a small archipelago on the northern coast of Dubrovnik. We have an easy 7-mile, 11-kilometer bike ride through some exotic gardens and valleys nestled among limestone hills. Today, I mostly use turbo, just because I'd proved to myself I could bike, and because I had plenty of juice, small mileage, and it was fun. I had no worries about running out of juice with that short mileage, which is something you definitely have to pay attention to, because e-bikes are heavy, so you don't want to be pedaling back if you run out of juice. Sam, our photographer, had to use turbo all the time to zoom ahead of us to catch us in action climbing or going down the mountain or hill. And many of his photos are on the webpage for this episode, so please check them out. He's the one who told me how much fun turbo was. Thanks, Sam! After our morning ride, it was time to head to spectacular UNESCO World Heritage Site Dubrovnik, arguably one of the most scenic cities in Croatia, perhaps even in all the Balkans. Dubrovnik has an absolutely charming walled city with a meticulously maintained old town inside. In its long history, it's had two massive life-changing events, a large earthquake in 1667, and then in the 1990s, during the war, they were cut off from the outside and were deluged with shells and snipers during a 7-month siege. Some of the exhibits I went to showed what happened during the war, and they're heartbreaking. Jenny and I walked up to the fortress on a tall hill overlooking the city, which I might add, took my thighs a few days to recover from. Like I said, the best views are up on these fortresses, but they're a lot of work. And it was a lot higher than it looked. Inside this fortress, they showed photos taken during the war, and they were very sobering. We all know of war. My father fought in three, World War II, Korea, and Vietnam. I was a small child, actually, when he was in Vietnam. But it wasn't until I arrived in the Balkans that war, real war, understanding war, hit home as a thump. It was in-my-face reality. It was no longer some foreign concept of something you read about in the paper and you feel somewhat removed from. Here, in the Balkans, I feel these people's pain. As I produce this show, I've been in the Balkans for 2 months. I'm making a concerted effort to take a history tour in each country to try to understand what the heck happened here in the 90s. It was ugly, awful. You still see signs, especially when you're outside the tourist areas. Personally, I think anyone who has the power to start a war should come visit this area and see the physical scars of the people and the buildings, as well as the photos, that hope to make sure people never, ever forget. It is heart-wrenching. But no war can detract from the beauty of Croatia or the friendliness of its people. Even though they have far too many consonants in their alphabet for me ever to be able to speak Croatian, I managed to get around just fine. And in these areas, if you find yourself in trouble communicating, just find a young person. I heard umpteen times that the young people around here learned to speak English on the Cartoon Network, for Pete's sake. And the teachers, once they started schools, just polished off these kids' English. I mentioned I arrived during October. I think this is a great time to visit the area. September probably might be a little bit better because more things will be open. It's a very tourist-concentrated country to visit, and so once the tourists are gone, a lot of things tend to shut down, but the weather was wonderful. And it could also be because things have just opened up. I traveled during COVID. But the good thing about this is, regardless, the masses were gone. I hear that during the summertime, Dubrovnik is overrun with cruise passengers. But when I was there, only one cruise ship was in port, and that city could easily absorb that amount of guests. Most of the time, of course, we were on the islands instead of the mainland, so we rarely saw any tourists at all. Tourists do visit these islands, and there's a ferry that can get you there, or of course you could take a private boat, but certainly not as common as it is for folks who mostly just visit Dubrovnik and Split, and actually then just Split. Now let's talk a little bit about eating in restaurants. Because Dubrovnik and Split are so popular with tourists, most menus have photos or translations in multiple languages, even the good restaurants. Most of the times I would say, when you see that, run. That means it's too touristy and they don't care about the food. But they just have to deal with so many different cultures that can't speak their language. So like I said, you're going to see pictures on almost all the menus. So don't worry about trying to figure out what you're going to eat. The Croatian language itself is a little bit complicated, but you can get by with just Hvala for thank you, Molim for please, Dobar dan for good day, Juvali for cheers, and you're going to get by just fine. I don't think I mentioned earlier about tipping. In Europe, or actually anywhere, it's a good idea before you head over to Google tipping culture of whatever country it is that you're visiting. Spain and Portugal, another country I'm visiting, don't have much of a tipping culture, although there are situations there where you do tip. In the Balkans, however, you do tip. But you have to tip in cash because they don't have a line on your credit card statement for you to do that. This also makes sure that the tip goes to the server and not to the management. Over here, as well as actually everywhere, I get my cash from a debit card using a bank ATM. I use the Charles Schwab because they reimburse me any bank fees. And you got to use the banks. I found they don't do that if you use a non-bank ATM. You also get the best exchange rate this way. The big problem is the ATMs tend to give you large bills. So one of the first orders of business is breaking down these large bills because the small places, restaurants, they can't break them. So for me, I found going to the grocery stores is the best place. They get lots of cash. They actually like getting rid of some of the small bills for a large bill. Another good place is the gelato places. They are very busy. Another place that gets lots of cash, don't mind breaking a bill. So buy a 1 or 2 euro gelato and you can break a 50. One of my favorite stories of my trip happened in Dubrovnik. After our tour, I booked 5 days there in a lovely Airbnb up on the hill just outside the old town that overlooked the sea. I wanted to take a day tour. I saw one in Airbnb Experiences that offered a local's guide to visiting a private estate's garden. I'd get a private tour of the historic town of Stone and visit the guide's own home where he'd get to see how he makes wine for the family and get to taste it. This sounded like a wonderful way to spend the day. The only problem was it required at least 2 people. This, unfortunately, is a problem I ran into my entire trip traveling solo, particularly in the off season. I had met Randy from the boat tour, and he'd also be staying a couple days in Dubrovnik, so I asked him if he'd be interested in joining me on this tour, and he said yes. We were met promptly the next morning by a woman, not the guy I was expecting, that told me about his hometown in the ad, and she wasn't even from Stone, the town we were supposed to be visiting, knew nothing about being a guide or about taking us on a tour to this home. It was not what I booked. She was simply a private transportation. This is nice, but we could have gotten to both destinations we were going to by a public bus for a heck of a lot cheaper. I decide we're going to deal with Airbnb later so as not to wreck the day. Of course, I was mortified. Not only was the day pricey, but it also sucked up an irreplaceable and valuable day of Randy's holiday. Gratefully, Randy exhibited one of my favorite traits in a human being. He was a good sport. No whining about, this wasn't what I promised. He kept telling me, stop worrying, it's fine. Let's just enjoy whatever this day offers. So thank you, Randy. You sure made not only that day fun, but you made me feel so much better about botching the plan. So the gal takes us up to these gardens. I'm picturing beautiful botanic gardens. Here we are on this Mediterranean climate where everything grows terrifically. What she drops us off to is a rundown, not much to see here, folks, kind of a place. It was only moderately interesting, totally overgrown, but we did get to see the disbanded wine and the olive press room, a couple of nice olive groves, and like I said, lots and lots of overrun gardens. During the day, I told Randy about a story I heard about a pregnant woman who was so excited about having a new baby. When she gave birth, she discovered the child had Down syndrome. And the way she explained it was, imagine you are so excited. You're going to Paris. You've dreamt about Paris all the time in joyful anticipation of this trip. But when you get off the plane, you discover you didn't land in Paris. You're in Amsterdam. It's still great, just not what you were expecting. This story became the inside joke as the day progressed. When we arrived in Stone, a village with the largest remaining defense walls in Europe, we climbed the walls around Stone itself, but the entire 1,200-meter, 3,600-steep wall looked thigh-busting. With no guide, we had no idea what the history of the wall was, but I learned later on a later tour that the little stone area of the wall was built not just to protect the people, but also the salt flats. Salt at the time was more valuable than gold. So Randy and I joked about a ridiculously ill-informed self-guided tour of the salt flats that we'd seen in Stone, the garden, the walls for the rest of the day. When we got back to Dubrovnik, I invited Randy over for a beer on my terrace. The sea, of course, was beautiful, but the highlight of the day for us, and mind you, we'd done this big, fancy, expensive tour, the highlight of the day for us was watching a crew of tiny ants quickly finding our spilled popcorn, seeing them haul this bounty to their nest that was in the brick wall adjacent to our table. It was the hardest I've laughed in ages. The ants themselves were quite impressive. The next day, I took the first ferry over to Lochram Island, an island I could see from my terrace. It had a fortress. Like I said, you're going to see fortresses everywhere in Europe, but it also had a botanical garden. This garden was what I was expecting the day before. And while I didn't have a guide, at least there were signs so I knew what I was looking at. And it was lovely. After a cafe lunch, I head for the return ferry, and who do I see coming off the boat but Randy? He didn't notice me, so as he passed, I yelled out, Randy, welcome to Paris! We both got a kick out of it. Randy, I truly, truly appreciate your great attitude. It made the day fun and memorable instead of uncomfortable. And the laughs we had were worth the lousy non-tour. That actually was my first bad Airbnb experiences tour. All the rest I've taken have been wonderful. The guide, which turned out to be a travel agency tour company masquerading as a private individual, gave us the partial refund I requested without question. They claimed it was a mistake in the booking. I'm not so sure about that, but I'm going to be a bit more careful in the future. The city of Dubrovnik is beautiful and has lots of fun things to do. I bought the tourist pass, which gave me a discount or free admission to many museums, churches, and exhibits, and I took advantage of all of them. You can walk the entire perimeter of the wall, even have a drink at the bar clinging to the outside wall overlooking the sea. Speaking of walls, some people plant capers in cracks in the walls, so you'll see cascading foliage that they can harvest these little caper seeds later. It was both picturesque and practical. I learned that they build the alley so tight because it helps block the sun and therefore the heat during the summer. The many dead ends and maze-like corners make it easier to catch thieves as well. Below my apartment on the water, back in medieval times, visitors would be quarantined to make sure they weren't bringing a disease to the walled city. That showed foresight. It was easy to keep myself busy for the 5 days in Dubrovnik, and I could see why it's so popular. During the Ottoman Empire, Dubrovnik was also very smart. They retained a Swiss-like neutral position. They negotiated paying an annual tribute and thus managed to trade with the Turks to their east and south, and also maintained trade relations with the Christians on the other side. When you go to Croatia, make sure to take as many historic tours as possible. This whole region is fascinating. In fact, it said that Churchill believed that, quote, the Balkans produce more history than it can consume. I loved Croatia and encourage you to come visit this charming red-tiled roof country with the crystal-clear waters and rugged cliffs. You'll be welcomed and have a wonderful time in this most scenic and affordable European destination. I also encourage you to check out my website to learn more about boatbiketours.com, my new affiliate. They've got some amazing adventures that you can stay in the same place each night and bike and explore some amazing European destinations. Super cool. And I love not packing and unpacking and moving all the time. Touring by boat is the bomb. And be sure to get my monthly newsletter list so you get the travel planner for this adventure as well as access to all the travel planners. I only email once a month. I don't spam you. You can unsubscribe at any time, of course. To get access, email me at kit@activetraveladventures.com. Go to the activetraveladventures.com website and click on the Contact Me or Newsletter buttons. Your request comes to me personally as I am both host and janitor of this company. So please email at any time. Let me know what you're up to or if I can help you in any way. I'd love for this to be a two-way conversation. I make new friends this way. This is how I met Jenny, Noma, Peg, and Sharon, who have joined me on my recent adventures. If you want to travel with me, check out my link on the show notes or on the Travel With Me link on the website. This spring, I'm walking coast to coast on the new Costa Rica Camino and then spending the rest of the year working my way hopefully down to Antarctica. So far, I've booked tours to the Galapagos, Ecuador, doing the Amazon area, Patagonia, and climbing Machu Picchu, which my sister Terry just agreed to come on. If you join me, many of my affiliates offer promo codes to save you a discount. You can check out the website or email me, and I'll be happy to send you whatever it is that you need. Whenever you use my affiliates, you're not only often saving money, but you're helping to support the show at no additional cost to you. I sure appreciate it. Now that I'm retired, I really feel it, and I appreciate you using my tour links as well as my Amazon link and travel insurance links. I hope you've enjoyed visiting and biking Croatia today. I sure enjoyed reliving it. Thanks to Traveling Jackie and BoatBikeTours.com for an amazing adventure. Until next time, this is Kit Parks, Adventure On!